Objectives of this lecture is to understand regulation of gastric motility and emptying and applied aspect related to physiology of stomach with the physiology of vomiting. So let us begin. Rhythmic contractile myogenic tone of the stomach, it is due to presence of the basic electrical rhythm or the gastric slow waves. And gastric slow waves, they are produced due to cyclic changes in the membrane potential. The gastric slow waves, they are initiated by the pacemaker cells. They are the interstitial cells of Kegel located near the fundus of the greater curvature of the stomach. So the basic electrical rhythm, it represents a wave of depolarization of smooth muscles proceeding from the circular muscle of the fundus of the stomach to the pyloric sphincter. Gastric slow waves or basic electrical rhythm, it consists of an upstroke and plateau. It occurs at a rate of approximately 3 to 4 waves per minute in the stomach, at the rate of 80 to 20 per minute in small intestine, and at the rate of 6 to 8 per minute in the colon. The upstroke of the basic electrical rhythm, it is because of the flow of the sodium and calcium inside the cell, and the plateau, it is mainly because of the flow of calcium inside the cell. Amplitude of basic electrical rhythm, it can be modified by the activity of extrinsic and intrinsic nervous system, gastrointestinal hormones, as well as various paracrine chemical substances. Factors affecting gastric motility. These are the various factors that produces change in the amplitude of the basic electrical rhythm. Factors increasing gastric motility. These are the acetylcholine, gastrin, histamine, nicotine, barium, and potassium. These are the various factors that can increase gastric motility. And factors decreasing gastric motility, these are the enterogastrone, epinephrine and norepinephrine, atropine and calcium. These are the various factors that can decrease gastric motility. Types of gastric motility or gastric movements. So gastric movements, they are of two type: when stomach is empty and when stomach is filled with meal or food. So motility of empty stomach, it is of two type: migratory motor complex and hunger contractions. And gastric motility related to meal or food, it is of three type: receptive relaxation, it occurs when food enters inside the stomach; mixing peristaltic wave, it produces mixing of the food particles and it converts food into the chyme; and gastric emptying is the process by which chyme enters inside the intestine. Movement of the stomach when stomach is empty. First of all, the migratory motor complexes. These are the peristaltic wave that begins in the esophagus and travels through the entire gastrointestinal tract during the interdigestive period. The migratory motor complexes, they remove any food remaining in the stomach and intestine during the interdigestive period. So they prepare gastrointestinal tract for the next meal. That's why migratory motor complexes, they are also known as interdigestive housekeepers. The motor activity of MMC, it is initiated by gastrointestinal hormone motilin. The migratory motor complex wave travels at a regular rate of 5 cm per minute and occurs every 60 to 90 minutes during the interdigestive period. There is a close correlation of the basal electrical rhythm and the migratory motor complex. Here we can see the recording of the migratory motor complex and the recording of the basal electrical rhythm. When there are no migratory motor complexes, the basal electrical rhythm, it consists of oscillation of the resting membrane potential between minus 65 and minus 45 millivolt. And during the migratory motor complexes, the electrical oscillations are superimposed with spikes. Here we can see the spikes that occur during the migratory motor complexes. A second type of the gastric movements that occur in the empty stomach, these are the hunger contractions. So these are the mild peristaltic contractions that occur in the empty stomach. They gradually increase in the intensity over a period of hours. And these hunger contractions, they are associated with sensation of hunger. When they become extremely strong, they fuse to cause tetanic contraction. They last for 2 to 3 minutes, which can be felt and may even be painful. And this is known as hunger pangs. Migratory motor complexes, they are probably responsible for hunger contraction in empty stomach. Receptive relaxation and accommodation, these are the gastric movements followed by meal. And because of that, stomach can store more amount of the food. Receptive relaxation is a vagovagal reflex which is initiated by the distension of the stomach and is synchronized with the primary peristaltic waves in the esophagus. The passage of food inside the stomach, it stimulates stretch receptors of the oral region of the stomach and produces relaxation of the fundus of stomach. The inhibitory neurotransmitter responsible for the receptive relaxation and accommodation is either vasoactive inhibitory peptide or nitric oxide. Vagotomy abolishes receptive relaxation, so it shows role of the vagovagal reflex in the receptive relaxation and accommodation. This figure explains role of the vagus nerve in the receptive relaxation and accommodation. Here we can see the record of the pressure inside the stomach and the volume which is present inside the stomach. At the starting of the experiment, stomach is empty. When food enters inside the stomach, even after that, the pressure inside the stomach, it remains normal because of the vagovagal reflex and the relaxation of the fundus of the stomach. It produces receptive relaxation and it can accommodate more amount of the food. When vagotomy is performed and after that we eat food, then it can rapidly increase pressure inside the stomach, which explains role of the vagus nerve in the receptive relaxation and accommodation. And because of the vagus nerve as well as the vagovagal reflex, stomach can accommodate more amount of the food without much increase in the pressure inside. Once food enters inside the stomach, it produces another type of the movement of the stomach. These are the mixing peristaltic wave. So peristalsis is coordinated pattern of the smooth muscle contraction and relaxation, where wave of relaxation precedes wave of contraction, and it is produced by periodical changes in the membrane potential, change in the basal electrical rhythm. Mixing peristaltic wave, it starts in the middle of the stomach. It produces digging inside the cavity of the stomach and it produces churning of the food particles in the lumen of the stomach. Gradually, the mixing peristaltic wave, it moves towards the pylorus of the stomach and it strikes against a closed pyloric sphincter. And this type of the movement is known as propulsion of the food towards the pyloric sphincter. When peristaltic contraction, it strikes against a closed pyloric sphincter, small amount of the content, it enters inside the first part of the duodenum, and most of the majority of the food particles, they again force back inside the stomach. And this movement is known as retropulsion. So the propulsion as well as the retropulsion, it produces churning of the food and it converts large food particles into the small food particles, and only the food particles less than 2 millimeter size, they can enter inside the duodenum. Food stays in the stomach for 2.5 to 3 hours. Food in the stomach is semi-solid and leaves stomach as a chyme, which is liquid. Gastric emptying occurs when the chyme is decomposed into enough small pieces to fit through the pyloric sphincter. So when size of the food particles in the chyme which is less than 2 mm, then it can leave stomach and it can enter inside the duodenum. So there is progressive wave of the forceful contraction occurs, which sequentially involves enterum, pylorus and the proximal duodenum, thus all three function as a unit. Contraction ahead of the advancing gastric contents, it prevents bigger food particles from entering inside the duodenum. Chyme is pumped in a beat, so a small amount, about 2 to 7 ml at a time, enters inside the small intestine. So gradually slow emptying occurs from the stomach into the first part of the duodenum. Now let's summarize movement of the stomach. During the resting state, basic electrical rhythm it is observed in the stomach as well as the rest of gastrointestinal tract. It is because of the activity of the pacemaker cells of GIT. Pacemaker cells of the GIT, these are the interstitial cells of Kegel, which produces periodical change in the membrane potential, which produces slow wave or the basic electrical rhythm. Now the movement of the stomach, these are of two type. When stomach is empty, it shows migratory motor complexes during the interdigestive period. And when stomach remains empty for a longer duration of time, it produces hunger contraction. When we eat, food enters inside the stomach and it produces receptive relaxation of the stomach, so stomach can accommodate more amount of the food. When food enters inside the stomach, it produces peristaltic contraction, and this peristaltic contraction, it moves from the fundus of the stomach towards the pylorus. It produces churning of the food particles, and the large food particles, they are broken down into the small particles, and it converts solid food into the chyme. When food particles, they are broken down into the small food particle, it is known as chyme, which gradually leaves stomach by the process known as gastric emptying, and gradually chyme enters inside the first part of duodenum. Factors affecting gastric emptying. First of all, the volume of food. When we eat more amount of the food, it increases radius of the stomach. An increase in the radius of the stomach, it increases tension on the wall of the stomach according to the Laplace law, and it increases gastric emptying. Gastrin also promotes gastric emptying, and gastric emptying also depends on the type of the food ingested. So gastric emptying is rapid for the carbohydrate rich food, gastric emptying is slow for the protein rich food, and gastric emptying it is slowest for the fat rich food. So when we eat fat rich food, it remains in the stomach for the longer duration of the time. Various duodenal factors can also affect gastric emptying, like enterogastric reflex. Enterogastric reflex, it is initiated by stimulation of the receptor in the duodenal mucosa. Because of the distension of duodenum, acidity of the contents, pH less than 4, high or low osmolarity of chyme, and presence of the fat as well as the protein digestion products, it produces inhibition of the enteral propulsive contraction and increasing slightly the tone of the pyloric sphincter. So it decreases gastric emptying. Various enterogastric hormones also decreases gastric motility, like cholecystokinin, secretin, gastric inhibitory peptide, vasoactive inhibitory peptide. These are the enterogastric hormones. Whenever released, it decreases gastric motility and gastric emptying. This inhibitory effect from the duodenum, it prevents rapid emptying of the stomach, and it prevents electrolyte disturbances. Fluidity of chyme also affects gastric emptying. So the rate of the gastric emptying of the solids, it depends on the rate at which the chyme is broken down into smaller particles. Liquids empty much faster than solids. Other factors that affect gastric emptying, like emotions, anger and excitement increases gastric motility. Fear and depression, it decreases gastric motility. And vagotomy, it slows gastric emptying. From all this previous information, you have already learned about the function of the stomach. So now I am going to give you quick and brief information about the function of stomach. Mechanical function or the motor function. Stomach, it is useful for the storage of the food, mixing of the food, as well as the slow emptying of the food inside the duodenum to prevent electrolyte imbalance. Digestive function. Protein digestion occurs inside the stomach by pepsin, and it is the 10% of the total protein digestion occur in the intestine. Fat digestion. Triglyceride containing short chain fatty acids, they are digested by gastric lipase. Absorption function. So little absorption occurs inside the stomach. Ethanol, it is absorbed rapidly in proportion to its concentration. An intrinsic factor which is secreted by the gastric mucosa, it is useful in the B12 absorption in the small intestine. Protective function. HCl present in the gastric juice, it kills the bacteria and other harmful substances. Peptic ulcer. Peptic ulcer occurs due to damage to the mucosal epithelium of the stomach and duodenum. Causes of peptic ulcer. The main cause is the damage to the mucosal bicarbonate barrier. So normally mucosal bicarbonate barrier, it prevents damage to the gastric mucosa from HCl and pepsin. And it occurs because of the infection of H. pylori. H. pylori decreases secretion as well as the activity of somatostatin and decreases secretion of bicarbonate. And in this manner, it disrupts mucosal bicarbonate barrier. Ethanol, vinegar and bile salts, they also decreases mucosal bicarbonate barrier. NSAIDs, anti-inflammatory agents, they decreases synthesis and secretion of prostaglandin E2. Prostaglandin E2 normally decreases activity of histamine. So whenever prostaglandin E2 synthesis decreases, then it increases activity of histamine on the parietal cell, which increases secretion of acid and it can produce peptic ulcer. Another common cause of the peptic ulcer is the hypersecretion of gastric acid. It is commonly observed in the patients with a congenitally elevated circulating pepsinogen 1, which can increase secretion of the gastric acid. Increase in the secretion of the gastrin can also increase gastric acid secretion and peptic ulcer. In the patient with a pernicious anemia, where parietal cell mass decreases, it results in the elevated gastrin levels, and this elevated gastrin levels, it can increase gastric acid secretion. Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, in which gastrin-secreting tumors or the gastrinomas, they can increase secretion of the gastrin, and gastrin, it can increase secretion of the HCl from the parietal cell and increase secretion of the histamine from the enterochromaffin-like cell, and this increased secretion of the gastric acid, it can produce peptic ulcer. Now, a brief information about the management of the peptic ulcer, depending all the principle that you have learned. Antacids, they can be given. They neutralize acid in the stomach and it can protect mucosa. Histamine receptor or H2 receptor blocking drugs like famotidine and cimetidine, it can be given, which blocks activity of the histamine on the parietal cells of the stomach. H+, K+, ATPase blocking agents or the proton pump inhibitor drugs, omeprazole and pantoprazole, they can be given. It can decrease secretion of HCl. Muscarinic receptor blocker like atropine, it can also decrease gastric acid secretion. Surgical treatment, it can be given if drugs are not useful. And in the surgical treatment, bilateral vagotomy with the resection of the gastrin producing pyloric part, it can be done. Whenever tumors they are present inside the stomach, sometimes total gastrectomy is performed, where lower part of the esophagus is directly sutured with a jejunum and it results in loss of functions of stomach and it results in pernicious anemia because of the absence of the secretion of intrinsic factor of Kessel. Protein digestion is normal because only 10% of the protein digestion it occurs in the stomach and remaining protein digestion it occurs in the small intestine. Iron deficiency anemia occurs because of the decreased absorption of iron because of the decreased conversion of Fe+3 into Fe+2 inside the stomach. Damping syndrome, it is commonly observed in the patients after total gastrectomy. It results in the weakness and the dizziness after meals. It is because of the rapid passage of the food from the esophagus into the small intestine, which increases rapid absorption of the glucose, which produces hyperglycemia. Hyperglycemia increases insulin secretion, and insulin, it decreases blood glucose, producing hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia produces weakness as well as the dizziness after meals. Rapid entry of the hypertonic meal in the intestine, which causes movement of the water in intestine, producing hypovolemia and hypotension. Physiology of vomiting. Vomiting refers to forceful expulsion of contents from the stomach and intestine. Initiation of the vomiting occurs because of the activation of the vomiting center as well as the activation of the chemoreceptor trigger zone. Vomiting center, they are situated in the reticular substance of the medulla. Direct activation of the vomiting center can occur because of the intracranial injury or increase in the intracranial pressure. Various visceral afferents through the vagus nerve as well as the sympathetic nerve, they send information about the local irritation of the mucosa to the vomiting center. This local irritation of the mucosa, it stimulates 5-HT3 receptors which releases serotonin and it activates this visceral afferents. Vestibular nuclei, it can also activate vomiting center and it mediates emetic response to motion sickness. Higher centers, they can also activate vomiting center and mediate emetic response to stimuli such as nauseating smell, sickening sights and some previous memory that can activate vomiting center and it can initiate vomiting. Chemoreceptor trigger zone, they are situated near the area postrema and chemoreceptor trigger zone, they are activated by circulating emetic substances as well as circulating emetic agents. The circulating emetic substances, they are commonly found in the patient with the uremia and radiation sickness, and circulating emetic agents such as apomorphine, digitalis, and the glucosides, they can initiate vomiting. Efferents from chemoreceptor trigger zone as well as the vomiting center, it passes through trigeminal, facial, glossopharyngeal, vagus, and hypoglossal cranial nerve to upper GIT and spinal nerves to respiratory muscle as well as the abdominal muscle, and it activates sequence of the mechanical events in the vomiting. It includes pre-ejection phase, retching phase, as well as the ejection phase in the vomiting. Pre-ejection phase, it is the initial phase in the all the mechanical events associated with the vomiting. So first of all, gastric relaxation occurs, which is followed by retroperistalsis. Feeling of nausea occurs, which is associated with the stimulation of the salivary centers, and excessive salivation occurs, and it is associated with rapid and irregular breathing. Pre-ejection phase, it is the initial phase which is associated with the mechanical events in the vomiting process. So first of all, there is gastric relaxation occurs and retroperistalsis occurs inside the stomach, and it produces feeling of the nausea. Stimulation of the salivary centers, it produces excessive salivation, and breathing becomes rapid and irregular. Now the retching phase of the vomiting. In simple words, retching means sound associated with the vomiting process and various movement associated with the vomiting. So in the retching phase, closure of the glottis occur, and it prevents aspiration of all the vomiting contents. Along with the closure of the glottis, there is contraction of the abdominal muscle as well as the diaphragm occurs, and it increases intrapulmonary pressure. This increase in the intrapulmonary pressure, it compresses the esophagus, which produces all the sounds as well as the movement during the process of the vomiting. Ejection phase of the vomiting process, it starts with the contraction of the pyloric part of the stomach. So from the pyloric part of the stomach, all the contents, they are pushed towards the fundus of the stomach. Contraction of the abdominal muscle as well as the diaphragm, it produces increase in the intra-abdominal pressure. It again pushes all the content from the stomach towards the esophagus. Antiperistalsis occur in the esophagus, that pushes all the content inside the esophagus towards the oral cavity. In this manner, all the content from the stomach as well as the upper part of the small intestine, they are removed outside the body. This mechanism, it is useful because all the irritant products in the stomach as well as in the intestine, harmful chemicals, whenever they are ingested, they are removed by this process. So this is a protective mechanism also.